Have you ever wondered how you would fare if real life were more like a video game? Would your style of play be like how I played Pokemon when I was 7, funneling all of my time and energy into one singular venture, one singular Pokemon, only to be left defenseless if, or more so when, they were defeated? Or is your style of play a bit more balanced? Spreading yourself out, progressing slowly down the main quest line, but also taking your time to explore the various side quests that game might offer. Of course, that type of strategy takes a lot more time. However, the experience gained could potentially balance out your shortcomings and leave you with multiple options in the face of unexpected adversity. I recently got a boom of subscribers from that animation video. Thank you very much, by the way. So, if you happen to be new here and you're wondering why this channel so far consists of that animation, two videos on sake, a reaction to Fan of the Opera, and a very, very bad, boring book review, this might help provide some clarity. Up until 2016, I played my life the former way, funneling all of my time and energy virtually into one basket at a time. But in today's video, I'm gonna talk about how I made some really radical improvements over the past couple of years, which led to the creation of this side quest goal system, and ultimately why it's the reason this channel exists at all. I know that the vast majority of these basically go unread. However, if you've ever taken a look at my channel description, it basically says I am a corporate drone in rehabilitation. That is not drug or alcohol related rehab. It more so refers to the fact that American culture really, really likes to hone in on the fact that success only pertains to the main quest line. When you're a kid, that's doing well in school. When you're a teenager, that's getting into a good college. When you are a young adult, that means graduating from said good college and getting a good job, etc., etc., etc. If you really want to put a marker on how much we value success, look no further than the actual definition of the American dream itself. The American dream, by definition, is the ideal by which equality of opportunity is available to any American, allowing the highest aspirations and goals to be achieved. That says nothing really about being a happy person. It just says we are going to allow you the opportunity to get a lot of stuff done really fast. I will say over time, the culture has become much more forgiving of personal views of success versus just the standard cultural view. However, many of us still follow that traditional, very commonly traveled road of expectations. And to be blunt, for a lot of people, this works. There's never really a problem with it. However, there's always going to be an issue with only focusing on one particular thing. And the issue itself is very much aligned with the opening metaphor. When one specific thing or the main quest is the only thing that you consider high impact and high urgency, what happens to you if you can't complete it? A significant roadblock to the American main quest line can come in a variety of forms. Obviously, most people go through setbacks when it comes to getting into the right college or finding the dream job or getting engaged to the love of your life. However, there is a significant difference between those that just simply struggle with it and have hiccups like everyone else versus those where it truly shakes them to their core. That type of reaction is 100% preventable. Time also seems to follow Parkinson's principle or Parkinson's law. The amount of time that we allot for any project, we as procrastinators and as human beings will find some way to fill up that time. Meaning, when some people find a significant obstacle to this main quest, instead of considering another option, we'll just contribute more and more time and energy into potentially overcoming this obstacle because there's no other path to follow. They turn this already daunting priority into their only priority, leaving absolutely no time or energy for anything else, and that's not healthy. Our usage of time is like investing money, but in reality, isn't it way riskier? You can't get more, you don't even know how much you have, so why wouldn't you diversify to some extent? Why wouldn't you hold side quests to a higher priority? I speak very passionately about this subject because I in particular fell into this hole very early on in my life with regards to work. At the time, I was working in software development and I was working for a very horizontal company. Though I thought I was entitled to more money or maybe a higher position, the horizontalness of the company didn't allow for that. I kept hitting roadblocks no matter where I looked and became obsessed with trying to fix this problem to the point where I was just poisoning the well for everything else. So it was draining the passion I had for my hobbies. It was taking time away I had with my friends so I could gripe about it. It was just very, very negative. As these career problems kind of bled into my life, luckily I caught that pretty early and really tried to figure out a way to get out of that mental jam. I became the number one purchaser of Barnes & Noble, assumingly, that month because I just started picking out every self-help book I could find for some sort of miracle answer. I didn't exactly get a miracle answer, but I at least got a good lead as far as how I could develop the miracle answer for myself. The book I ended up coming across that ended up being a pretty big help was Level Up Your Life by Steve Camb. Steve Camb, the author, is also the host of channel Nerd Fitness here on YouTube. And this book is mostly written from the perspective of a physical trainer trying to motivate people to get healthier. Instead of focusing on deprivation and grit like 90% of weight loss books, he focused on having his audience create an extravagant list of goals and dreams and even personal things that they wanted out of life and for physically enable of attaining because of their current lifestyle. Anything from feeling very confident and beautiful in their wedding photos to climbing Mount Kilimanjaro, he had people write it all out. As the name Nerd Fitness implies, he's a really big gamer and I believe a LARPer as well. And so he created this gamified experience. He had everyone sort their goals, which he called quests, into specific categories. He assigned them EXP and then actually arranged all of them in separate levels by difficulty. He also had people assign specific prizes when they achieved levels that usually somehow pertained to how healthy they would be at that period of time. So obviously at level zero, the prize wouldn't be flying out to Hawaii to run a half marathon. While my problem has never been concerning health or fitness, one thing that Steve's book really helped me think about was the prioritization of goals. For every category that he had people sort things into, not a single one took precedence over the other. Things for health were equally as important as things for work, which were equally as important as things for your family. No category trumped another because when you start doing that, then ultimately you slip back into the first problem, which is making one thing your main quest and everything else an ancillary thing that you don't prioritize at all. The more I thought about goals or quests like that as equal footing with one another, the more reasonable that idea became. Nothing in life exists independently. Every aspect of your life flows into it. If you're happier with your home life, you're gonna bring a better self to your job. When you're bringing your better self to your job, you'll probably make more money. When you're making more money, you'll get to do more extravagant, fun things. It's all a cycle. By focusing exclusively on one thing, you're really robbing yourself of the opportunity for that recursive momentum to really kick in. And ultimately, I was hurting myself more than I was helping myself by focusing myopically on one thing. And so that was when I started to use Steve's ideas to create the side quest system. So being a hashtag gamer girl myself, I also call my goals quests now. I find it to be more fun. Most people will think it's cringe. I don't care. I enjoy it. The first question is, what's worthy of a goal or what's worthy of a quest? For me, it's things I know would have a high rate of return on either happiness or quality of life for me or the people around me. So not necessarily things that you just like have on your to-do list, like going to the grocery store, but things that would overall change your current situation. From here, similar to Steve's path as well, I also sort all of my quests into different categories. Now for me, I use 7 categories. Physical, mental, lifestyle, adventure, stability, gratitude, and master. These are my categories, but what are yours? Maybe leave me a comment below of what your quest categories would be or how they would differ. Maybe you want to have a lot more. Personally, I break my categories further down into subtypes. So for example, under stability, I have quests that are for financial stability as well as emotional stability. Again, similar to Mr. Steve's path, this is the part where we start assigning EXP. Now, as a former developer myself, I am very familiar with the old Scrum methodology and how they use story points within that framework. So we did something similar. When I was first creating the quest list from scratch, I picked the item that was the least impactful and easiest to complete and assigned it 5 EXP. From there, I use this as the benchmark to determine the EXP for all the other activities in increments usually of 5. So if something seemed about twice as hard, it'd be 10 EXP. If it was 10 times hard, it would be 50 EXP. For me personally, I ranged all of my regular quests from 5 to 50, and for the master ones, which are those really paramount moments in life that you would feel really tremendous amounts of regret if you missed, I leave those all at 100. Where I start to differ from Steve is determining whether or not things are quests or if they are outcomes. Now, obviously, there's a lot of things that we'd like to do in life that we don't have a tremendous amount of control over, but we would still like to have as a to-do. For example, getting promoted. You can do a lot of things that lead to a promotion, but ultimately someone has to pick you. You can't pick yourself. I actually have a specific checkbox that notes and moves over the quests that are actually outcomes, just that I always see them as something that I would like to do and can maybe factor in some minor quests in between to get me to a point where that decision for an individual would be easier to make. Another one I have is credit score. Obviously, you can do a lot of things to improve your credit score, but ultimately that number is designed by some inhumane algorithm up in the cloud. So who knows? So at this point, before the new year starts, right around this time of year actually, I sit down, I make a list of the quests that I would ideally like to complete by the end of next year, and then at the end of each quarter, do a self-check to make sure if I need to add anything or remove anything to make myself happier. The real kicker though, unlike most goal-setting systems, is that each category holds equal weight, and therefore you should strive to have equal amounts of EXP per category. Now granted, it's really hard to do this at the end of each year because like there's just not enough ideas sometimes, or sometimes you're really focused on something given your stage in life. However, that's when you can really use those quarter end checkups to ensure things stay balanced and see if you're really leaning towards, you know, considering things as the main quest again versus a bunch of side quests to keep you well-rounded. Now here is where I take the prioritization of all things very seriously. At the end of the year, if things have specific firm deadlines, so if it's a test that can only be taken at a specific time of year, or if it's a vacation that you'd like to ideally take on a certain date, I start sending out of office requests for those if needed right now. Now, obviously, all jobs for the most part have some specific amount of time you can take off, and this is actually pretty helpful for determining your quest for the next upcoming year. I've also found it when you give employers a larger opportunity to foresee when you will not be available, they're usually a lot more accommodating with what amount of time you can take off. For me, I work for a company where there is no limit, which ironically actually makes people take off less time. So by doing this, I not only guarantee that I do use up my time to take off, but I'm using it in a way that I know is going to leave a meaningful impact. Now the software you've been seeing on the left-hand side of the screen has been Notion. It's a free software, it's really great. You've probably seen a bunch of productivity YouTubers yap about it already. And if you're interested in seeing this template, I'll actually link it on my Ko-fi page or coffee page. Still don't know how to pronounce that yet. It's essentially a free version of Patreon where instead of having to donate money, you can electively do it. So go nuts, use the template to your heart's content. Like I said before, everything feeds into itself. And when I started using this system, it encouraged a tremendous amount of change within me. When you prioritize everything, it kind of acts like that domino meme. You feel so much more fulfilled and you find that one interest directly impacts more and it just keeps getting more and more fun. For example, one of the first things I prioritized, even though it sounds like it's completely out of left field, was daily journaling. I had been seeing all these really creative people daily journaling in these adorable Hobonichi Techo planners on Instagram, and so I wanted to do that. I started doing it daily, which I hadn't been in the art community for around like 6 to 10 years. So getting back into art also got me back into digital art. So I started using Procreate on my tablet. Using Procreate on my tablet got me interested in possibly creating fun graphics for work content. Fun graphics for work content got me sucked into creating fun work videos, which I had never done before. I had never even filmed videos before, but ultimately that and becoming really interested in that got me into creating YouTube videos here. Everything's connected. What I'm really trying to say is no matter how fringe an interest may be, you don't really have any idea how much positive impact it could have in your life. It's a really corny statement, but chasing your bliss is one of the most redeeming things that you can do. And that's ultimately what I'm doing here with this YouTube channel, and that's why there's such a hodgepodge of content at the moment. All those videos represent some sort of bliss I was chasing in the moment. And hopefully things are gonna get bigger and better from here on out. I've got a lot of cool stuff planned for 2022. That saying, a jack of all trades is a master of none, is actually a half-stopped quote. The rest of that statement goes, and oftentimes better than a master of none. So remember that the next time someone said you're maybe spreading yourself too far out. Moving forward, I'm actually gonna create a specific playlist and little graphics at the bottom whenever I'm doing a video that relates to a quest. And I'll make this page public again on my Ko-fi as well in case you ever wanna check in and see how everything's going. Spoiler alert, this quest page might give you some insight on upcoming videos. Just so you know. Again, I welcome my new audience. I'm really thankful you're here. Lots of fun stuff in the pipeline, and I'll see y'all next week. Cheers.
I got the broccoli. I'm gonna
clap for it. Come on. Clap for it. Yay! Good boy!
my favorite trick.